Mphasis is trading and sort of under pressure on the back of first quarter earnings, which were largely in line with street expectations. It's been one of those big performers this year, 2018. Muted revenue growth of only 4.3% was a bit of a dampener. Rukmini Rao, my colleague, caught up with the management. Let's listen in.
I think primarily the vectors of growth we identified over the last few quarters are what we're executing on. Clearly, in our direct business, we are very pleased with the fact that our strategic accounts continue to shape up really well. I mean, that's our primary turf battle because that's it's a wallet share play, and I think we're executing really well, especially in new gen areas. Secondly, I think the Blackstone portfolio opportunity that we started mining last year continues to play a pan out well, and that's given us good revenue momentum, you know, as we start converting those deals that we won into revenue. Also, we are executing well on our new logo acquisition process. So I think those were the three vectors within the direct business. On the HPDXE side as well, I think we started a new partnership in FY18, and I think that's now panning out and turning into revenue as well this year. Clearly, FY18 was a growth breakout year for both our businesses. I think the direct business already had a good trajectory, but we turned everything else around that. We think this year is going to be basically continued growth from the four vectors that I just talked about.
Sure. Nitin, but banking and capital markets seem to be a little flattish. Can you give us a sense of what is happening there in that space? And perhaps for, and because insurance is doing pretty well, what do you see, or when do you see, you know, good growth coming back for banking and capital markets?
Actually, if you peel away our India business and the flat digital risk business, our direct banking and capital market business actually has grown really well for us. So, otherwise, our direct core business would not have grown because you know, we are very largely dependent. Almost 75% of our revenue comes from BFSI, but 50% is banking and capital markets. So I think what really skews the or dampens the growth is the legacy India business that we basically are defocusing from, as well as the fact that the DR business is kind of flattish and we are stabilizing that revenue. But if you peel away that and if you look at our direct top clients, strategic as well as new logos, we are actually seeing some really strong growth in our banking business.
Sure. Can you also talk about the pipeline, which seems a little healthy?
I think the pipeline has actually been fairly robust and we've continued to add new deals to it. Two things to note about the pipeline. Firstly, it's a good healthy mix of what we call digital deals as well as legacy deals that now need transformation, which is important because you know it's important to kind of play in both sides of the deal flow. Secondly, our average deal sizes in the pipeline as well as in the conversions have actually started to go up, which basically means that our ability to drive transformation deals that run more than on a project basis is now getting recognized, and that gives you a little more visibility into long-term revenue. So I think we're pleased by both of these developments.
Sure. Surya, a word on the margins, of course, you've announced a buyback. What do you see the cash position going forward post the buyback?
Yes. So we have around $400 million of cash as end of the quarter one. The buyback, it will cost us around $145 million. That leaves us around $250 million after the buyback. But that is, the buyback is planned by, outflow will happen by end of Q3. By that time, we would have cash generation for couple of more quarters. So we are quite confident that with the cash generation quarter on quarter, we'll have a good cash and we could virtually recoup this in three quarters time.
But largely on the capital allocation policy per se, what is the road ahead?
Let me take that.
Sure.
I think, if you think about it, right, there are three core buckets of the capital allocation strategy. Firstly, we've had a good practice of giving out healthy dividends every year. Roughly 50% of our retained earnings we pay back as dividends. So that's one use of cash. Second, I think we've earmarked a certain amount of cash for tuck-in or inorganic plays. Of course, we have to find something that fits our needs, but we are in constant search for the right asset. And thirdly, I think if there is excess cash, we'll find ways to continue to return it to shareholders on a case-by-case basis. So I think it's really the three-pronged approach to cash and capital allocation. Of course, we make continued investment in R&D and our next labs and our Sparkle labs.